Park Dispatch. Bonjour.
Hello, this is Masaki Hayashi from the University of Calgary. I am a hot spring researcher. I'm just about to enter the protected area around Kidney Hot Spring.
Okay, thank you. I'll disregard any intrusion alarms.
Okay, thanks. And then we'll call you back again once we're out. Well, we're at the Kidney Hot Spring. This is one of the series of springs. This is the second highest one in a series. So that is the source of the spring. Once upon a time, they were actually using this hot water and then bringing it to this cistern here. And then there was a piping system going to a town site below. The cistern is not accessible to public because there are these endangered snails here. There are about five springs here. Eventually, we hope to identify the areas where this water is coming from. An obvious thing to do, just drill down and then find out where the water is coming from. And we can't do it here. So what we do is basically listening to the pulse of water. When you go see a doctor, the first thing they do, they put this stethoscope and they listen to you. And then from that, you know, listening to the pulse, the doctors can gather a lot of information. So that's what we're trying to do here. Instead of digging, we monitor the temperature and the chemistry of water and also how the flow rate changes. Some of the springs have this rapid, you know, fluctuation, large fluctuation. Some of them actually stop flowing completely, whereas the others seem to be flowing at a very steady rate. So that must be, you know, something to do with how the water is supplied from the sources. There are a lot of minerals in this spring because this water comes up from the deep, and also the high temperature means there's a higher density to dissolve all these minerals. The mineral deposits around this upper hot spring, that is very, very, very old. So that would indicate that upper hot spring has been flowing over thousands of years, even a longer time period. So it's unlikely that this is going to stop flowing completely. And the fact that this really hasn't dried out even during the period of drought would indicate that there is probably a buffer there that will sustain at least some of these springs against changes in climate and wet and dry cycles. How does the water get into that depth in the first place? And there are some conflicting theories. One theory is that there is a valley behind this sulfur mountain, and then groundwater is recharged on the other side of that mountain and then just dips down into this zone of crushed rock and then coming through. And then the other theory says that that's not the case. It's actually on the other side of that Randall Mountain. That's where the water is entering into this. There is also an idea that, well, maybe the water is recharged somewhere way up there and then flowing through this crushed rock and eventually popping up here. Until we have gathered enough evidence, we can't really tell which theory is correct. If Parks Canada has that kind of information, they can manage certain areas so that they don't risk altering the flow of springs. Or maybe they can change or improve their strategies for recovery of the endangered species living around the spring. So we're ready to go out of this restricted area, leaving the spring, and until next time, which will be 2 weeks later.
Like the winter sun shine.